Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Welcome back to Sunday Morning and the Old Cookbook Show. Today is a very special episode, so I'm uploading it Sunday morning, Australia, New Zealand time. This is a recipe for our Commonwealth cousins. 2 years ago to the day, pretty much, April 28th or 29th, 2019, I uploaded a cookie recipe that is very common in early Canadian cookbooks from about 1900 to just before World War II, called Dad's Oatmeal Cookies. And down in the comments section, I had a ton of comments from people that live in New Zealand or Australia that said, those are almost like Anzac biscuits. I had never heard of Anzac biscuits. So it sent me down a rabbit hole to figure out what these were. And I meant to do this recipe a year ago, but you know, this little thing called COVID sort of threw everything to the side. Anzac. For everyone outside of Australia and New Zealand, Anzac stands for the Australia-New Zealand Army Corps. And this term was coined somewhere between December 1914 and April 1915, when the Anzacs waged their first battle in Gallipoli in World War I. And it was a combined military force from Australia and New Zealand, just like it sounds like. They are part of the British Empire, just like Canada. And when World War I started, we were all lumped together and sent off to war. And this battle at Gallipoli is sort of a bonding moment for those countries. And so April 25th, the day of the Battle of Gallipoli, is a day of remembrance in Australia and New Zealand, and it's called Anzac Day. And this biscuit recipe has become woven into the fabric of that remembrance. And it comes out of this idea that during World War I, families in Australia and New Zealand would send care packages to their loved ones who were fighting in Europe. And they would send biscuits that could handle the travel. And my research has sort of led me to believe that this cookie wasn't yet invented during World War I, that there were a whole range of other biscuits and hardtack that were sent that became known as Anzac biscuits, and that the defining sort of recipe for this sweet version didn't happen until after World War I. And as part of that earlier video on Dad's cookies, I got mail, actual physical mail, which I love getting, and lots of people from Australia and New Zealand sent me recipes, their contemporary recipes, what they believe to be Anzac biscuits, which led me down to do some research of my own and pick up some cookbooks from the time period. And so the first cookbook that I'm going to reference is this one. This is the Auburn Methodist Tested Recipes, published in Melbourne in 1919. And it is a fantastic cookbook, published just after the end of World War I. But nowhere in this book is there any mention of Anzac biscuits. In fact, there are no biscuit or cookie recipes that even resemble Anzac biscuits, which follows along with the history that I've been given over the last year and a half or 2 years of researching, that the recipe that we're going to do today didn't exist yet. There's a recipe from 1917 called Anzac biscuits, but people say it's not a real Anzac biscuit because it doesn't have oats and it doesn't have coconut, nor did it use golden syrup. Three elements that are really part of this biscuit. Now, we've come forward to the next edition. This is the ninth edition of the Auburn Methodist Tested Recipes, published in 1923. So a few years have gone by between the eighth and the ninth edition. And in the biscuit section, there is nothing called Anzac, but in the cake section, there's something called Anzacs. And they have almost all of the elements of an Anzac biscuit except for the coconut. But the other ingredients are the same, the method is the same, and I'm not surprised that it's called a cake. When I go back to cookbooks from England, Scotland, Wales, from say the 1700s and earlier, what we today would call a biscuit, or here in Canada a cookie, were often in the cake section, and they were called cakes, like Tantallon cakes or Welsh cakes, or another one that we did on the channel is called a tosset cake. Almost or essentially cookies or biscuits, but they were called cakes. So this doesn't surprise me. This is just called Anzacs, but it has all of the things that you would expect. It has oats, sugar, flour, melted butter, golden syrup, boiling water, carbonate of soda. pretty much exactly what I've got out here with the exception of the coconut. So we're getting onto the right track, which brings me to the shower cookery book. This is the 8th edition from 1939, and this is a in its time period, a very famous cookbook. The author of this cookbook taught at cooking schools. This cookbook was used as a textbook in cooking schools. And so it has a recipe for Anzac biscuits that we're going to do today. And it is pretty much almost what a contemporary Anzac biscuit or an Anzac biscuit in 2021 would be. Now, this recipe is pretty straightforward. Equal amounts of rolled whole flake oats, dried coconut, unsweetened coconut. This one calls for caster sugar and flour. Now, a word about measurements. This is an Australian cookbook pre-metrification. And much like Canada pre-metrification, they used a different sized measuring cup than they do today. Today, Australia, New Zealand, Canada, we all use the same measuring cup. It's often called a metric cup. Sometimes it's called a Commonwealth cup because it's used by Commonwealth countries. And it's the equivalent of 250 milliliters. Pre-1970s, before Australia and New Zealand metricated. Before they metricated, we metricated a little bit later, but went through the same process. The measuring cup was changed. And so I had a conversation with someone at the Australian government who sent me a package of PDFs that talked about going metric. Prior to going metric, a standard measuring cup in Australia was 227 milliliters, which coincidentally was the same size that Canada used. So all of the measurements that I'm using today reflect that. Another little snag with measuring in Australia is they use a different sized tablespoon. Canada and New Zealand use the same size tablespoon, which is 15 milliliters or the equivalent of 15 milliliters. Australia uses a tablespoon that is 20 milliliters. So when you're doing recipes, especially from the internet, you have to take all of those things into account. And most of the time, it doesn't really matter. That difference of 5 milliliters isn't going to make a huge difference for most recipes. So that was melted butter I just poured in. So I'm just gonna mix that together. So it's not a huge deal. It's not a huge deal. It's just one of those things that you should be aware of. Now I just wanna mix this together until the flour and the oats look like they're well coated with the butter and I don't see any dry bits. We're looking good. So I've got some water that's just boiled. To that, I'm supposed to add some baking soda and a dessert spoon of golden syrup. So I'm gonna say that a dessert spoon is that much. Now the golden syrup is slightly acidic. It will start the baking soda to activate. And I laugh at dessert spoons because the author of this cookbook goes to great pains at the beginning to tell you how many salt spoons are in a teaspoon and how many teaspoons are in a tablespoon, but at no point says anything about a dessert spoon. So I just took that to be the common amount of today. One dessert spoon equals 2 teaspoons, so about 10 mils. I might have put in a little bit more. Now, mix this all together until it comes together. And of course, if you live here in Canada or the United States, and you can't find golden syrup, in a pinch, a dark golden corn syrup would definitely work. That came together quite nicely. As much as I've been researching this for a long time, and I have had long email conversations with people, and I have gone through lots of cookbooks, comparing recipes, assembling cookbooks so that I could do this, I decided not to make these biscuits until right now. So this is the very first time that I've made them. And I was a little bit worried that there wouldn't be enough liquid to kind of pull all of this together, but there is. This looks quite nice. Now, the next direction is to bake them. And I'm a little surprised at how small the author wants you to make them. 1/2 teaspoon quantities on well-greased tins, leaving a space between each as they spread. Bake in a very slow oven as they burn easily. half a teaspoon is a very small amount. So these must be super tiny. So let's pull out a baking sheet and get them in the oven and see what happens. So this scoop is half a teaspoon. Let's see. Pretty tiny. Also, very difficult to get out of the scoop. Do you think that's far enough apart? I guess we're gonna find out, won't we? And in they go.
Hey, Glenn.
Hey, Jules.
Hi, friends. I arrived just in time.
So, Anzac biscuits.
Very nice.
The recipe called for half a teaspoon per biscuit, which gives you a very small biscuit.
But it does make them very shareable.
Very shareable. I sort of partway through said, I'm gonna make the normal size that I would make. And so that's the difference. And in these older recipe books, I see half a teaspoon or a teaspoon as the most regular size.
These are pretty tasty. Definitely Dunkin' cookies.
So I'm not a fan of coconut in anything, really.
I know.
But it kind of works in those.
Well, yeah, it's got that dad's cookie kind of coconut thing going.
Very much like a dad's cookie, almost.
I'm gonna have another.
Dare I say, kind of like a hobnob, too?
It is. It's got that, the way hobnobs are just kind of basically butter, sugar, and oats.
Oats. So on the tree, the family tree of biscuits, I think that those three are very similar to each other. Now, when I went through all of these recipes, this one used white sugar. Some of them used brown sugar. Some of them used white and brown sugar. And in the comments section, I see there's this group of people that like a really crispy, hard cookie, and people who like more of a chewy cookie. And I can see how, okay, so that's where those differences come from,
in the
type of sugar that you're using. In the end, I don't think this biscuit is about the recipe so much as it's about the sentiment of what this day stands for and what they represent.
I concur.
So, let us know down in the comments section all about your family recipe for Anzac biscuits. Thanks for stopping by. See you again soon.